Inshallah. I want to start by telling you a story. When I was 12 years old, my grandmother told me this story. It was a story of a little boy who was standing at the edge of an ocean. And there were millions of floundering fishes around him. And he was picking one fish at a time and throwing it right back into the ocean. He picked up another fish and he threw it right into the ocean. I'm sure many of you have heard this story, but when I heard it when I was 12 years old, about this little boy picking up a fish and throwing it into an ocean. And there was a man many yards away who was watching this young boy picking up the fish and throwing it right back. He walked up to the boy and said, "Little boy, what are you doing? There are millions of fish that are dying around you. Why are you picking up this one fish and throwing it right back? What difference is it going to make?" And the little boy replied, "Even if I save one fish, I have made a difference in the world." Ladies and gentlemen, that's what I want to talk to you about today. Can one individual, an inspired individual, make a difference? In today's Pakistan, we need to weigh the pros and the cons. Often we talk about the negative side of our country. We talk about gender inequity, we talk about children dying, we talk about illiteracy, we talk about the economic downturn. And most importantly, we talk about a leadership deficit. We talk about corruption. We talk about the inability to address issues. However, there are positives as well. Pakistan today has many positives to talk about. We can talk about a young and vibrant population, the youth bulge, as it is called. It can be a positive or a negative. We can talk about an entrepreneurial culture. We can talk about risk-taking. We can talk about the belief in latent ability. We can talk about an ample natural and geographic resource base, which you earlier heard about as well, which we still need to leverage upon. We can talk about roads, telecommunications. We heard the story about telecommunications as well, and basic infrastructure that is available. We have an independent judiciary, and we can talk about thriving, interconnected urban centers, which can become the intellectual drivers of change for our country. I'm often reminded of a quotation by Nelson Mandela. Civilizations and nations have to go through a lot of endurance. They have to go, it's like climbing a hill. You start climbing upwards, and someone like me will probably give halfway through because I'm totally out of physical, you know, endurance and capacity. I never exercise for one. However, you keep climbing a hill as a nation. You get to the top and you realize there are many more hills to climb. So history is in the making. We may be at one epoch. We may be at one era in time and may believe that there is a lot of hopelessness as far as our country is concerned. But we do not realize that this is history in making. And this is just one hill we have to climb. And we will climb many more and we will, inshallah, continue. So if we look at the scale of imagination of individuals, can individuals make a difference? And I'm going to talk about four individuals that have influenced my life. Nelson Mandela, I talked about already. He gave South Africa the end of apartheid. He believed in truth and reconciliation, the ability to admit one's mistakes and say, yes, I can make a difference. And that is what Pakistan needs today. We need tolerance, we need truth, and we need belief in ourselves. Dr. Muhammad Yunus, who inspired me, and I will tell you my story in a little bit. Dr. Muhammad Yunus, who changed the destiny of a country that Henry Kissinger called the basket case of the world. A country that was tormented by natural calamities, that was tormented by a population that kept growing and growing and that had limited resources. And today, it is the second largest economy in South Asia. Ladies and gentlemen, that is a miracle of one man who believed that the poor need a different voice, that the poor need a different option of how they are seen by the world. Then there are our own heroes. Often in Pakistan, one of our mistakes is that we forget to celebrate our heroes. Sitar Abdul Eidi, and a hero who changed the lot of the disenfranchised, who brought their voices to our doorstep. And we have heard about technology. At the age of 26, Bill Gates was taken to be a maverick, a college dropout who knew nothing. That's what people believed him. And he gave one idea. He said, a PC in every home. So the right to information, and today the right to information has really changed the world. So individuals can make a difference. And sometimes all you need is a simple idea. So what's my story? In 1994, and I will quote a quotation from Paulo Coelho. He happens to be one of my favorite authors. He said, when you desire something, the entire universe conspires for you to achieve it. My desire was to come back to Pakistan and give back to women in my society, because I believed that they faced massive discrimination, and I won't go into it because we already know what the problems are. So this was something I believed, and I decided to work for the World Bank with the notion that a multilateral organization would give me the platform to actually work on my dream, the dream of removing gender inequity. And as luck would have it, in 1993, I met Dr. Muhammad Yunus at a conference. I didn't know who he was, and he inspired me. He inspired me with the idea of providing poor people sustainable financial choices. Very simple idea. Take money to earn money. That's all it means. Microfinance is simply you take money and you build up your capacity to earn more. That's it. Simple idea. Nothing very complicated. Didn't need an logarithm. Didn't need an exponential equation for us to solve this. Very, very simple idea. So I met him. He inspired me. I left my job at the World Bank. I ended up in Bangladesh. And I truly saw the miracle of microfinance. And that's what my institution means. It actually means miracle. And what are we simply doing? At one end, we are transforming the lives of families. And we realized very early on that it wasn't enough just to set up a not-for-profit. It was also important to set up a for-profit institution. And I'll come to this idea. Why is it very important that institutions that serve the poor must be for profit? And at the end of the day, my dream is that the Kash Microfinance Bank is traded on the NASDAQ. That is where we need to go. That is where we need to take institutions. That is where we need to take institutions that service the poor, that give the poor voice, and we need to bring them into the world of capitalism. Otherwise, we will not be able to make a difference. And that is what we did. In 2008, and I have a nice story to tell you about this, because the first ever governor, female governor of the State Bank, actually gave us the license for the Kash Microfinance Bank to the first ever CEO female CEO of a microfinance bank in Pakistan. So I feel very proud that women in Pakistan can and do make a difference. So in all this experience of doing this, what was my first challenge? My first and primary challenge, ladies and gentlemen, and this is my one message. If you go home today and you remember anything that I said, the one thing I want you to remember is it's about changing your mindset, knowing that you can do it and knowing that the other person needs what you have to offer them. So the first challenge for me was changing mindsets. The other was really all kinds of myths about women in Pakistan. People came to me and said, women in Pakistan, they don't work. It's the men who do all the work. Do you believe that? I didn't. They said, loan officers, women walking out in the communities, going out there and telling people and motivating them and mobilizing them, not gonna work. Not gonna have any traction. Not a good idea. Go back to academia. You'll probably, do better there. And they said to me, Pakistanis, dishonest people, bad people, don't lend to them. You'll never get your money back. Well, let me tell you, 99% of our money always came back to us. So that wasn't a problem. So we had many challenges. They related to convincing people. They related to motivating people. They related to coming up with a new idea, an innovation, and believing in that innovation. And it wasn't enough just to be convinced yourself. It was very important to start a trail. It was a trailblazing concept where you gave your idea to the next person and the next person took it to the next and so on and so forth. And it was like the floundering fishes were all back into the ocean. That's what we did. So another great idea. Dr. Muhammad Yunus, when I was starting out, told me, if you wait for the ideal world to happen, you will never be able to bring about change. We all realize in Pakistan, this is not the ideal time. We all realize this is not the most easy situation. We all know there are terrorist bombs out there, there are attacks, there's insecurity, there's lack of opportunity, there is unemployment, but there'll never be an ideal time. So we need to do something. What do we need to do? I talked about changing mindsets. The first thing that I learned from doing microfinance is that we have to create pro-poor financial structures. It is very important. Why is it that there's so much resource inequity in the world? There's trillions and trillions, I can't even count them, of wealth out there. And yet there are billions and billions of poor people. Something's wrong. Something's terribly wrong. We need to rethink and restructure. We have to change the mental models that we were taught in the Yales and the Harvard Business Schools or wherever we went, or the LUMS or wherever we study. We need to change those mental models. We need to understand that individuals are not just driven by profit motivation. There's a whole concept of dignity building. We have to understand that it's just not about an exchange of dollars. It's not just about having bank accounts. It's human beings are much bigger than making profits. Why do corporations think like that? Why do we as managers assume that it's all about success is all about wealth? Why can't we think differently? And why do we think poor people only need charity? Ladies and gentlemen, business capital is unlimited, while funds for charity are limited. It's time that we began to treat poor people not as charitable options, not as the fish that we have to save, but as the ocean goers who are going to change their lives for themselves. So we need a new thinking model for poverty alleviation. What's our challenge, as I see it? Our challenge is that 65% of Pakistan's population today is below 24 years or 25 years. Many of these people are going to enter the job market as new entrants. The economy will have to grow at 12 to 14% to absorb the new entrants in the market. What does that tell us? It's not going to happen. Pakistan's economy today, I just read the IMF report, is going to grow at about 4%. So many of these people who are job seekers will not be able to find jobs. What do we need to do? We need to make job creators. We need to make entrepreneurs. Unfortunately, there is not a silver bullet for this. I don't have answers, but I thought I would share some of my ideas on how do you make entrepreneurs. We need to introduce financial education in schools. In fact, it is my recommendation that we entirely revamp our education system. It is time that we make people have skills that they can use and become creators of jobs for themselves and ultimately for others. I'll share an example with you. When we give out one loan, after 3 years, the same individual hires 5 more people. So there is a correlation of 5 times for every loan that we give out. Same way, if we educate our children to think creatively, and I had the opportunity to do that because I went to schools where I was taught to think as opposed to just learning by rote. So why can't we do that for everyone? Why can't we give people that opportunity? We also need to set up pro-poor institutions, and I've already talked a little bit about that. And we need to deconstruct mental models of how we think about capitalism, funding flows, or institutional structures for that matter. Other ideas is massifying youth training programs. All these people are coming into the job market. We need to give them the wherewithal to run businesses. And most importantly, and this is something I'm going to go back because Asad mentioned President Obama's speech, and he said something very interesting. He said, we all have common aspirations. I'll read the last line. Maybe we want to start a business without having to pay a bribe to anyone. What we need is to have a corruption-free environment, and we can do it. We can certainly do it. And incidentally, 5 years ago, in fact, yes, exactly 5 years ago, World Bank did a research where they looked at ease of business. India was at the bottom of the line. Pakistan was maybe number 5 or 7, which meant to set up a business in Pakistan was much easier. Now, unfortunately, the ranking is reversed. So ease of business in Pakistan is correlated endemically with corruption. And we as Pakistanis need to say no to corruption. It's time we said it. And if one individual can start saying that, I'm sure there's going to be a crescendo across the country. So what are some of the lessons that I can share with you as I end this? We have to be risk takers. As Pakistanis, we have to take some risks. The time is now. It can't be later. We have to ensure flexibility. There isn't one answer. There isn't one answer I can give you. There's no silver bullet to our problems. We have to negotiate. We have to improve our image. We have to persevere. We must never give up. And we must resolve our conflicts with mutual consensus. I know the 18th Amendment came up recently. I'm sure we have differing views about it, but it is a tool of consensus building. Let's build on that. Let's move ahead. And we have to have leadership. All of you are leaders. All of you can change. And I promised you I would sing. So please sing with me. Pak sar zameen shad baat, kishwar-e haseen shad baat, tu nizam-e azm-e ali shan, arz-e Pakistan, markaz-e yakeen shad baat, pak sar zameen ka nizam, quwwat-e aquwwat-e قوم ملک سلطنت پائندہ تابندہ بادشاد باد منظر مراد پرچم ستارہ و ہلال رہبر ترقی و کمال ترجمان ماضی شان حل جان استقبال سایہ خدائے ذوالجلال